Gee, what a great crowd on the Sunday after Thanksgiving. Folks at Guntersville Church of Christ, you are as welcome as the flowers in May. And especially this morning, because this morning we have a special service, a really special service. Make a couple changes there on your bulletin, if you will, take a look there. Buddy Petrie is going to lead us in our opening prayer this morning. And then you'll notice the message is absolutely blank. But think about this now, while you're anticipating Brother Gary Bradley speaking this morning, because Philip is on the way back from Greenville, and we're all praying because of all the traffic. You remember he mentioned a couple of Sundays ago, 431 had gotten like, Interstate 65 had gotten like 431 on Friday afternoon. There just isn't much room there. So we need to say a prayer for Ben, too, because he's on the way out to Little Rock. Okie dokes. Brother Gary is going to speak to us this morning. And I want you to be thinking about doing our duty. Let me soak in, Brother Gary. We enjoyed that adult Sunday school class this morning. This was just great. It really is. Tell me this, you all. What kind of morning is it this morning? Hey, good morning, indeed. Thank you very much for attending. I know you had a good time on Sunday. We're catching up with our Thanksgiving today because we all went in different directions last Thursday. But one of the fellows on the staff at the radio station told me Friday morning, said, you know, having the relatives over on Thanksgiving eliminates one big problem. And I said, what's that? He said, leftovers. They've been coming over now for about 30 years. About the only thing we have to get rid of is them. Everybody was thankful, sure enough, at the first Thanksgiving, if you'll think back. The pilgrims were thankful they'd landed safely in the New World. And the Indians were thankful they hadn't landed 200 years earlier. Thank you for attending this morning. Let's sing with Brother Buford Bagwell leading our singing this morning really loud and get ready for a delightful message.
Please stand.
The wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. Thank you.
We'll sing this next song, and Brother Petrie will direct your mind.
Are you wearing my heavy burden? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you grieving over God's pardon? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's alone. You have no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. Do not tear slow down your cheeks and begun. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Have your sins that to my eyes are given. Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You have no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. Do you fear the gathering clouds of sorrow? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you anxious? What will be tomorrow? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You have no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone.
Will you pray with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day you've given us, Lord. Another day we can come to your house and worship you and come together and celebrate your death. Lord, I ask that you be with us through this service, that you open our minds up for the words that are spoken, the songs that are sung. And Lord, I ask that you let those words penetrate our hearts and let them guide us through this next week and through all of our life, that we show who you are in us. Lord, I ask that you be with the ones that we mentioned earlier that are traveling, all of our family that are traveling through this holiday season. Lord, I ask that you let them get to their destination and back home safely, Lord, if it's your will. Lord, I ask that you be with all the men and women that are serving our country overseas that are not going to be together this holiday season. Lord, I ask that you be with them and keep them safe and bring them home. Lord, I thank you so much for sending your son to die on the cross for us. If it hadn't been for him, we would not be here today, Lord. Lord, I ask again that you just lead and guide us, direct us in everything we do. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, buddy. Now we have a chance to give back to our Lord, and the men will begin taking up the offering as we begin singing, and then we'll have a prayer of thanksgiving.
For the beauty of the earth, for the beauty of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord, how all to thee we raise this our sacrifice.
Father, as we come to you in prayer, Father, we are thankful for all the material blessings that you've given us, Father, for our jobs, our businesses, for our abilities to work, Father. Father, as we have those abilities and we understand that we're stewards of all that you've given us, Father, as we give back just a small portion, Father, of that you've so richly blessed us with, we pray that these funds may be taken to be able to be used to expand the borders of your kingdom and to be able to show others your light. And it's through the Son, through the name of your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ, we ask these things. Amen.
As we prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, we'll sing this next song, after which Brother Jim Ellis will come forward and speak before us.
King of life, I crown thee now.
In this time of year, when we are reminded to give thanks for family, for loved ones, and for special memories that are focused around the Thanksgiving holiday, it's also a special opportunity to remember what the Lord has done for us. We gather at this communion table this morning to offer thanks for the most gracious gift that we could ever receive, that of forgiveness of sin and for the promise of eternal life. To help us prepare our thoughts, I wanted to share a couple of the Psalms that I think are very reflective of a thankful heart and the merciful nature of God. In Psalm 100, the psalmist writes, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. And in Psalm 103, the first part of that book, David writes, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. As for a man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower in the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts." Let's just take a moment this morning to offer thanks to the giver of all good things as we go to our Father at this communion table. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this time that we have set aside each Sunday morning, each Lord's Day, to remember what Christ did for us when he went to the cross. Father, we are thankful for times in our lives of thanksgiving and that you give us a thankful heart. And we know, Lord, it's so easy to overlook the true blessings that you give us through Jesus, not just in our daily lives and our families, but just the simplest gift of all, which is what he did at the cross. Simplest for us to receive, and yet we tend to forget the importance of it, Lord. So in this moment, we come to you and thank you, Lord, for Jesus, for his life that he lived on this earth, for the message he delivered, and for being willing to fulfill his mission to go to the cross and die for our sins so that we could be with you. And Lord, we ask for a special blessing on this bread this morning. Help us to be reflective in our hearts as we partake of this together as the body of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's pray once more. Our Father in heaven, we approach you just to thank you for the blood of the Lamb, which this emblem is representing, or this fruit of the vine represents the innocent blood that was shed by Jesus. And we're thankful for this, just that we can be renewed in our thoughts, in our lives, in our hearts. And Lord, just I pray that this week you would help us to take this emblem and just remember throughout this week what the Lord has done for us, that it would not just be a moment this morning, that we would just take this with us every day. And we again thank you so much for your mercy and for this cup. In Christ's name, amen.
We're so excited to have Brother Gary Bradley and Bobby with us today. And before he speaks to us, please stand and we'll sing this next song. And as we're doing that, the children may are invited to go to children's church ages 3 to kindergarten.
Jesus is
two weeks in July, we came over six Wednesday nights in a row, and I told you everything I knew and more besides. It was a wonderful time for me to study with you on the church and the falling away and the restoration, and we just love the Guntersville Church. I love the way you treat my family. I love the way that you love each other, and we're going to talk about that today. In traveling all over the country and trying to help churches grow, I guess there's one question that I ask that's really the wrong question. Like the phone call I got, I told a Sunday school class the other day. The woman called and said, what can we do to help the church grow? Well, that's not the right question. What can I do to help the church grow? Because you see, we haven't grown since 1980. We haven't grown as a brotherhood since 1980. And so the question is, what can I do to help the church grow? That's not the question. The question is, what's keeping the church from growing? That's the question. What's keeping the church from growing? In other words, by that very question, we're saying that there is within the church the ability to grow if we'll just let it. If we'll just let it. In other words, sometimes I want to say, just get out of the way. Get out of the way and let God work in our lives. Amen? Paul said, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gives the increase. We're not in the increasing business. We're in the planting and the watering. And when you plant and you water, when you live it and you teach it when you get a chance, and just back up and let the Lord work. Let the Lord work in our lives. Sometimes we hit a brick wall. Sometimes we hit a situation where we think we're not making any progress spiritually in the lives of people that we love. And we just need to step back and let the Lord work on them a little while. Two Fridays ago, Veterans Day, Bobby and I did something we hadn't done in a long time. We went to the Veterans Parade in Huntsville. And it was such a wonderful reminder of what others have done for us. In the parade, if you happen to be there or you've seen one, you know that in this one particularly, they started with the Second World War. And the vehicles came by with the men who are now in their 80s and even some in their 90s that served in the Second World War. And then following that was, of course, the Korean War and then the Vietnam War and each war as they would come along. And walking, we had to walk a long way because we parked way over there and had to walk all the way to where the parade was. And every time we would see somebody that wore a hat or indicated that they was a veteran, then we would say how much we appreciate your service. We left there and went to a restaurant. And in fact, it was that night. And a man came in and had on a hat and had U.S. Marines, Vietnam, baseball cap, military hat. And after Bobby and I had eaten, I noticed a little girl over in the corner got up and walked all the way across the restaurant and walked up to that man who must have been in his 80s. And she said, I want to thank you for serving our country and serving us. The reason I'm telling you this is because every time I said that or that little girl mentioned it to that Marine, this individual said the same thing. I was glad to do my duty. Young folks, that's unfortunately a four-letter word that has lost its meaning. It's taken on a meaning that is drudgery. I'll do it, but it's my duty. We've forgotten the joy that comes from doing your duty. Duty is not bad. Duty is responsibility. Duty is stepping up to the plate and doing what you're supposed to do. Duty is getting out of the way and letting God's family grow like she should. A young mother came to us the other day. They are expecting their first child. She's very apprehensive about it because of her age. She said to Bobby, and Bobby told me later, you know, wives tend to do that. She said to me later, do you know what she said? And I said, no, what? She said concerning her husband, who is a fine young man, been to Afghanistan twice. She said, I hope so-and-so, her husband, pays as much attention to our baby as he does his dogs and his hunting. That's serious, isn't it? I hope he pays as much. In other words, I, as a father, I hope he does his duty. I hope he does what is expected of him. And as I travel all over the country and talk to churches and leadership about the church and the future of the church, it always boils down to this. Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing in view of my ability and my opportunity? It's amazing how much ability we have in the church, and it's amazing how many doors the Lord opens for us. Then that equals our responsibility. You know, I've been at Mayfair 37 years, and I could get my feelings hurt because they've never asked me to lead singing. There must be one reason for that. And the only reason I can think of is I can't sing. Oh, I can make a joyful noise to the Lord, but I can't sing. well enough to lead an audience like this brother does. And so then our ability, what is it? Our opportunities, where are they? That equals responsibility. I'm going to go back into the Old Testament. I know the preacher that you have here doesn't know anything about the Old Testament. So I double-dog dare him that I would go to the Old Testament. There's a man named Jonah. Oh, yeah, you know. It really hurts me that so many of our wonderful biblical stories have been delegated over to children's songs. The belly and the whale and all of this, and the skeptics have made so much fun out of Jonah. But the most powerful thing about Jonah is when Jesus was asked, by what signs do you do these wonderful things? He thought so much of the story of Jonah, and the Jews thought so much of the story of Jonah, that it was not a parable, it was not a fairy tale, it was not just a funny little story, but it was so powerful that Jesus used it to prove. He said, there shall be no sign given you but that sign which was given to you by Jonah, who was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale. So shall the Son of Man, he's referring to the resurrection. So shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the depths of the earth. That doesn't sound like a fairy tale to me. If I was trying to convince an audience of the reality of something, I wouldn't tell some fairy tale. I wouldn't tell some joke that some skeptic had made fun of in the Old Testament. And so the Lord kind of put his stamp of approval on this story that we're going to talk about for a minute this morning. And that is a man who was commanded by God. Open your Bibles. Can you find the book of Jonah? It's one over there. If you find Obadiah, then you'll find Jonah. And then just right after that is Micah. So maybe you can find Jonah. Let me give you an outline of the four chapters of Jonah. It kind of sums up a lot of people's lives. Chapter number one, Jonah runs from God. Isn't that interesting? Chapter two, Jonah runs back to God. Chapter three, Jonah runs with God. Chapter 4, Jonah runs ahead of God. Read that this afternoon. It's one of the most interesting biblical stories you will find in God's Word. It has so many, many, we've been hung up on the big fish. We've been hung up on whether or not that was a whale or whatever. And we've forgotten the real meaning of the story. Brethren, are you listening? The powerful story behind this is God cares for lost people. Now you can take that to the bank. God cares for lost people. All right, it started out, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, go to that great city of Nineveh and preach against it because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord. Have you ever tried to do that? Have you ever tried to run away from? Isn't that kind of ridiculous? It's kind of like Adam and Eve. You know, our first mother and grandmother and father, they tried that. They tried to hide behind something that the Almighty God, who just created the heavens and the earth, had just brought into existence, and they were hiding from God. No, you can't hide from God. But let's talk about Jonah and the predicament he found himself. First of all, the command is quite obvious. It's very, very clear. Jonah, man of God. See, later on, when you read the story this afternoon, you'll find that when he got on the ship to go to Tarsus, a storm came. Every time, folks, you run from God, you're going to run into a storm. I promise you, you're going to run into a storm. And so Jonah ran from God. He got on the ship, went to Tarsus, which is the opposite direction to Nineveh. And then the sailors are so superstitious about what had happened, they threw off the cargo to make the ship lighter. They begin to question each one, have you offended your God? Have you offended your God? Have you offended? They came to Jonah and they said, Have you offended your God? And Jonah said, I am a Hebrew. I believe in the God. I believe in the God of heaven. And they said they knew he was running from God because he told them so. And they said, what are we going to do? He said, I'll tell you, throw me overboard. And they did. And you know the story. But the point is, God's commands are clear. There are some mysteries. There are some things maybe in Revelation that I don't really understand, that I'll have to wait till I get to heaven to understand. There might be some things in Romans that are kind of hard to work through. But when you come to what to do to be saved, when you come to how to live the Christian life, it's crystal clear. I've told you when I was here in June that the book of Acts, the book of conversion, the one that tells you what to do to be saved, is written on a sixth grade level. And so therefore anybody that can read on such a low level as the sixth grade can know what to do, how clear it is in the book of Acts. And so then our God's commands are clear. What constitutes our duty whenever God speaks? The word duty is only found twice in the New Testament. But there are many, many other words like must, like John 3:5. A man must be born of water and the Spirit. We all know what a must is, or an ought is, or a command. These are all words that are synonymous with the matter of duty. And so when we think about a command of the Lord, it's very, very clear. And he has a right, as the young man said in communion, he has a right to tell us what our duty is because he's our creator. He's the one who redeemed us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. But I think the clincher is found in Exodus chapter 5 when Moses appeared before Pharaoh, and here are these 2 million slaves that get all the work done, and Moses has the audacity to say, let my people go. Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Folks, I think that's the question we ask ourselves every single day. But we need to settle that question. We need to settle that question, who he is. He's not some old gray-headed Santa Claus that's just too good to raise one finger of retribution. But you see, God is our creator. In Acts 17 on Mars Hill, Paul says, it is in him that we live and move and have our being. It's because of him that we got up this morning. It's because of him that we've been so blessed. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 17 and 18. He said, it's not by your power or your might that you have what you have. God gave it to you. And so then it's very clear that when the Lord speaks, that constitutes our duty. What has the Lord said? What does God want me to do? We talked in class this morning about doing this pushback to the me generation, to me having my agenda, to me doing what. Do you know the difference between being saved and being lost? Is when you're lost, you're doing what you want to do, and when you're saved, you've made yourself available to do what God says. Look at the book of Acts, how many times it says, what must I do to be saved? They cried out, men and brethren, what shall we do? And so then when we get to the point that we are totally convinced that it's what God says that makes it our duty. It's kind of like my mother when she used to call me to supper. She would call and I was playing ball and I didn't want to quit, and she'd call again. But if she ever got to this Gary Marson Bradley, not many people know my middle name, that meant you better move. I knew then that it was about to be over. And when she said, Gary Marson Bradley, supper is ready, I knew to move, because Mother had made it very clear what she wanted me to do. And when the Lord has spoken to us in his word, Hebrews 11, in times past, it spoke to the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us through his son. I can't imagine anybody today saying, well, I just don't know what God wants me to do. I do. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, and you ought to read that book sometimes. It's about Solomon, who wanted to find out what's the most important thing to do in this life. Wine, women, and song. I've had it. I've done it. I got the t-shirt, everything. You know, I know. I've got the money. I've got the power. He closes chapter 12 by saying, remember the Creator in the days of your youth. That's good advice, isn't it? Chapter 12 and verse 1. But he said in 13 and 14, he said, hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. That sums it up, doesn't it? How do I sum up my life? Everybody tells me what to do. Everybody tells me which way I need to go and how I need to. The only responsibility you have is to listen to the Lord. We find that the reason Jonah ran was because what he was told to do was very disagreeable. It was unfortunate. Distance was involved. You see, Nineveh was way up here to the north. And he boarded a ship and went to Tarsus. That's the other way. He was about 500 miles from where he was supposed to be. But sometimes when we think about our duty, it's not popular. In fact, most of the time it's unpopular if you're trying to live the Christian life. And so sometimes it's disagreeable because of some difficulty. Sometimes there's some prejudice involved. I remember an old story told by Brother Nichols. I guess he told it at a preacher's class that we used to attend years ago, that there was a couple had quit going to worship, and they had missed him a couple of Sundays, and he talked to one of the leaders in the church there, and he said, we need to go see him. He said, it won't do any good. And Brother Nichols said, no, but we'll get credit for going. I think that's good. It's really not up to us, you know. We'll get credit for going. So things can be a little disagreeable. There can be some difficulty. There can be some prejudice involved. You see, Nineveh was the capital of Assyria. Nineveh was a huge city. The Bible scholars tell us that it was so large, it would take you 3 days to walk all the way around the city. It had 120 that didn't know their right hand from their left hand. Now, Bible scholars say that's babies. Can you imagine a town with 120,000 babies? It was a huge... It would be like the Lord coming to me and saying, I want you to go to Moscow, that great and wicked city, and I want you to preach to them because I want them to repent. You see, Assyria was their enemy. Assyria hated Israel. In fact, years later, Assyria came in and took the 10 northern tribes into Assyrian captivity and never returned. Those that finally dribbled back into Palestine were called Samaritans, who were part Assyrians and part Jews. They intermarried. They were kinfolks, but they hated each other. And so now God is telling me to go to this city that I hate, the people that I hate, the people that will destroy me if they get a chance, the people who ultimately led us into the 10 tribes into Assyrian captivity. You want me to go preach to them? Yes. Why? Because God loves lost people. You can't read Luke the 15th chapter and not conclude that. A man had 100 sheep. That's a lot of sheep. He just loses one. But what if that one is my grandson or granddaughter or husband or wife? And he leaves the 99 and goes after the lost sheep until he finds it. Same story with a woman and her bracelet. The same story with a man that had two boys. The only difference was when the young one asked for his inheritance to go spend it in riotous living, you remember the father didn't follow him to the far country. I think he stayed on the porch. And I think he kept looking and watching and waiting and praying and hoping he would come back. Hoping he would do his duty. In fact, in Luke chapter 15, verse 17, one of the sweetest verses in the Bible, it says, and when he came to his senses. Wow. You mean to tell me not that the people that live in a hog pen are not thinking right? That's right. We told the class this morning, to me, it's helped me so much in understanding about this crazy world that we live in, that I am commanded by God to accept everybody. Color doesn't matter. Conduct doesn't matter. I am to accept them in the fact that they are a person for whom Christ has died. They are made in the image of God. Now, do I approve of their decisions? No. Do I approve of their decisions to do whatever they choose to do? Of course not. That's what's wrong with our country. We've lost all respect for authority. Amen? We've lost all respect for authority. We must have authority or we'll have anarchy. And we're almost to that point. And so then it was difficult. There was prejudice. It was very, very unpleasant. And yet he tried to avoid his duty. Now then, let's talk about us. We've talked about Jonah. You know the story. God prepared a fish. He stayed in the belly of that fish for 3 days. The fish bit him up on the bank. He went into Nineveh. And of all things, they all repented. And in chapter 4, it made Jonah so mad. He just went and sat under a tree and a vine grew and shaded him from the sun. And finally the vine withered and died and he was in the sun. And God said, Jonah, you care more about that vine than you do those people in Nineveh. He didn't want them to repent. He wanted God to wipe them off the map so they wouldn't be a problem to us. And so it's one of the greatest chapters in the Bible on God's providence, on God's love for the lost, on God being everywhere, his omnipresence, because you can't run from God. Let's talk about our duty. It's very clear. Let's talk, first of all, about, I think, what has got to be the most important thing, and that's loving one another. Loving one another. Jesus said in John the 13th chapter, verses 34 and 35, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples. If we have the biggest building in town, no. If we have the best preacher in town, if we have, no. If you love one another. You see, and then Paul did us the greatest favor when he took this verb, this word love, agape, which is a verb because he breaks it down into the love language. He says love is patient. Oh, really? That's not one of my good qualities. I'm not very patient. You're not very patient when you don't cut anybody any slack, when you're judgmental, when you think that you ought to be first in line instead of last. But Paul says love is patient. And then he uses the word kind. How many kind people do you know? How many kind? Can you name them on one hand? I can. I can name them on one hand, the people that I think would be considered kind biblically. They never talk about themselves. It's always about other people. It's always the idea of what can I do to make things better for other people. And so he says, love is patient, it's kind, it's long-suffering. Now, that's an interesting word in the original. It means putting up with what you don't have to put up with. Boy, is that hard. Is that not very difficult? But he goes on and describes, he said, love doesn't walk around with a clampboard keeping score with what you've done wrong. That's the problem that I find in marriage counseling. It's when they're on the verge of splitting up, they come in and the fussing and the fighting has already taken place, and the first hour is spent with a long list of things that he's done and a long list of things that she's done. And I try to get them to see that this is not going to work until you both tear up those lists and make a list of what you ought to be doing. And then you make a list of what you ought to be doing. Not them, you. You see, it took me a long time to realize that you can't make people do what they don't want to do. The only one you have control over is yourself. And that's a full-time job, isn't it? And so then Paul is awfully clear when he says that we ought to love one another, even as Christ. You know, he always puts a hook in it, like in Ephesians 4:25, when he talks about, I believe it's verse 32. He said, I want you to be compassionate, forgiving, and loving one another, even as Christ also loved you. You see, we don't really have a choice. Because 1 John 4:11 tells us that he loved us first. Therefore, we ought to love others. And we break that down into caring and forgiving and accepting and giving people benefit of the doubt. You know how love is. It's not the Hollywood chill bumps. It's serving. I was in Cleveland, Tennessee last Sunday. And I got there a little early with the Central Church. And I got there a little early and I drove around in the community. The church building was on the main road and I drove back in the community just to see how it looked. There was a Nazarene church back there. It was a small little brick building, but it had a sign out front, Thanksgiving dinner for everybody in the community. Really? Thanksgiving dinner for everybody in the community. I thought, wow, that's a lot of people. I wonder how many is going to show up. I wonder if they'll run out of food. And so in the sermon, I was telling that, hey, your neighbor right down the street here is feeding all the people in the community. After worship was over, a lady was in a wheelchair sitting in the back, and I was back going through the building, and I shook hands with her, and she said, you know that church you talked about? I said, yes. She said, they're my neighbors. I lived near that building. They came to my house and knocked on the door and said, if you can't make it to the building, we'll bring Thanksgiving lunch to you. Wow. That kind of clarifies things, doesn't it? When you think about caring for the community, when you think about letting your light shine, when you think about being salt and light, when you think about watering and planting and watering the seed. And so we're commanded to love. Just like Jonah was commanded to go to Nineveh. We're commanded to love. We're commanded to worship. And I don't know why he has to tell us not to stop going to church. That's what Hebrews 10:25 says. Because I don't know what we would do if it were not for Sunday. When I stand before a crowd like this, like I do at home and like I do at other places, it just kind of blows my mind when I know, like I do at Mayfair, what the people in that audience have gone through that week. The pain, the suffering, the heartache, the fussing, the fighting, the bickering, the fear. I don't know what we would do if we didn't have Sunday. Because Sunday enables us to come together as a group of people. And none of us are perfect. That's the reason we're here. And we come and we lay it at the Lord's feet. And we listen to and sing the songs, and we listen to the prayer, and we have communion, and we open God's Word. You see, you don't read the Bible. The Bible reads you. That's the reason people who continue to live in sin don't read the Bible, because it condemns you on every page. And either you'll quit what you're doing that's wrong and get into His Word, that'll give you the strength to say no to what you've been doing that's wrong, or you'll just keep going to Nineveh, or to Tarshish rather. And you know the funny thing, they never have really found Tarshish. They don't know where it is. They don't know what city it was or anything about it. You know, when people don't want to do anything, one excuse is good as another. When I was at Brainerd years ago in Chattanooga, we had a man that we loved dearly. He never would obey the gospel. I talked to him one day because he was in the furniture business, and I went to him and we bought some furniture from him, and he was very kind, and I asked him why he came and why he hadn't become a Christian. He said, "Oh, I'm thinking about it." I said, "Good. You shouldn't do it without thinking about it." I said, but how long have you been thinking about it?" He said, 27 years thinking about it. How much time does it take for you to think whether you want to be a good example or a bad example? How much time does it take for you to come to the conclusion you want to be lost or you want to be saved? You want to keep making your excuses and going to Tarsus? You can't run from God. You can't run from your duty, really. It's inescapable. It's non-transferable. You can't get the preacher to do it for you. You can't get the elders to do it for you. My mother and daddy loved me better than anything, but they couldn't do one thing about my sins. Not one thing. It took Jesus to do that. And He'll wash yours away. When you say yes to the one that said yes to the cross. Won't you come while together we stand and sing?
Thank you.